एंड स्टडी ग्रुप वॉज स्टार्टेड इन 1992-93. एट दैट टाइम प्रेसिडेंट वॉज मिस्टर रोहिरा एंड पीओकिंग देसाई वॉज द चेयरमैन. सिंस दैट दिस एक्टिविटीज हैज बीन इंस्ट्रूमेंटल इन डिसेमिनेटिंग नॉलेज अमंग्स द प्रोफेशनल ब्रदर्स. And it is one of the most sought after and a star performer activities of the chamber. Today we have about 5 study circles, 1 study group and 2 intensive study groups. And we are going to announce 2 more study circles. It is not possible to have such this type of activity, prolonged activity and successful activity without dedicated and committed members. And if you think of study circle, persons like Dinesh Bhai, Dilip Sanghvi, Haresh Kenya, Ashok Sharma, Mohan Farke, and more many other names will come to your mind. One more name is Mahendra Sanghvi. Mahendra Sanghvi has always been active in the study circle and study group. And you just close your eyes and even think, you can imagine that Mahendra Sanghvi is arguing, either, propagating some argument with the or discussion with the speaker or talking something about the principles. I am very glad to present you before you my dear friend Mahendra Sanghvi, who is also a past president and a co-chairman of LNR committee. With these words, I will hand it over to the chairman, Dinesh Kenyan. Thank you.
Thank you, Yadinda. I welcome you all to the study group meeting on the topic of decision on the direct taxes. We have with Minor Bhai Simlik. As Yatin Bhai, narrated briefly, I just briefly introduce him. He is a practicing chartered accountant and a partner in the firm Sanghvi, Sanghvi and Sanghvi. He is a past president of CITC, currently co-chairman of the Law and Representation Committee of CITC, nominated as a member of the Regional Direct Tax Advisory Committee by the CBDT, a member of the Standing Committee on the TDS for Mumbai Region CIT TDS. Various lectures in the on the platform of Chamber, Bombay Chartered Accountant Society and Institute of Accountants of India. Regular contributor to the reference manual of the WRC of ICA. With these words, I will introduce Mahendra Sanghvi and I request all the members to welcome with a loud applause. I request now Yatin Bhai to offer a memento to Mahendra Bhai as a token of love. We have for a little words, we have with us Advocate Nanda Vaidya. Again, he is a very thorough professional. He is a practicing advocate in income tax matters, appearing before the High Court and Appellate Tribunal of Others. He was earlier working with the Hiru Rai and Arun Sathe. Regularly delivering lectures in the Various Professional Association. I request all members to welcome the Nanda Vaidya with a loud applause. And again request Yatin Bhai to offer a memento of his token of love and affection. I'll hand it over to Mahendra Bhai.
Good evening, friends, President, and colleague, co-speaker, Chairman, Vice Chairman, Ashok Sharma, Senior President over here, and dear friends. I once again thank Harish Bhai and Chamber for giving me an opportunity to learn certain developments that are taking place by way of the case laws and to understand the principles, the analogies, and more so the trend that the courts and the tribunals are being taking for various different sections. And of course the conflicting decisions that we come around of different courts and different tribunals. Friends, as far as what Yatin said, it has always been a pleasure, and I would say that first I am a student and then it's the different thing that I am on the other side today. Otherwise it's usually all along with the participants, and it has always been great pleasure to educate ourselves and even to share our views and our thoughts so that we have more clarity in our practice and it helps in our day-to-day practice. Coming to the subject, friends, the selection of case laws have been more so subject-wise, I would say. Of course, the latest ones are more so subject-wise. I would request the certain group that in intensive course study group to excuse me, pardon me for selecting few judgments which have been already covered in that study group, study intensive study course. And one other, as practice, we have been seeing that the management, the organizers do send us the list which has been covered in the last three, by the last three speakers. And I observed that one of there is a common judgment, but I, to the best of my knowledge, we had not discussed that. It was, when we come to that, it was in the case of recovery of Amul research. Now coming to our first judgment on the first batch is the reopening. Why we have taken reopening is for the obvious reason that I don't think any office would be left with a notice today that they have not received notice under section 148, be it for the purpose of bogus purchase, be it for the purpose of share premium or any AR information that they have. So that's the reason why the selection of first three judgments, for other I would say four, are on account of the recovery. Crown Consultants Private Limited, it's Bombay High Court decision by way of a writ. The facts are, it's pertaining to assessment year 2007-8. The order was passed under section 143.3. During the scrutiny, the addition was made on account of 40A-1A for payments made to stock exchange in respect of VSET charges, and the appeal was preferred against the assessment, scrutiny assessment of 143.3. CIT appeal observed, and then he directed to verify the investments made by the directors and relatives of the directors in the company. It was also observed by the assessing officer because of the directions given, and thereafter the assessing officer also had observed that huge transactions had taken place between the directors and the relatives of the directors and the company, and the same were not reflected in the financial statements, as well as they were not reflected in the tax audit report that we have on reporting on 269 SSNT in column number 24 A and B. The year-end balance were shown under the head margin money. The year-end balance of those directors and the relatives of the directors are not shown under the head of loans and advances, but it was shown under the head of margin money because the nature of the activity of this Crown Consultants Private Limited was a broking firm sort of. The transaction, the amount which was taken by way of a loan and returned back was not incommensurate with the nature of the business done on behalf of those directors and the relatives of the directors. So that was the reason why the assessing officer issued the notice under section 148. This reopening was objected by the SSE, and the reason given for the against that objection for issue of this 148 notice was, one, that this assessment is beyond 4 years. Secondly, we had disclosed all the facts fully and fully. This was what the reason given, and thereafter saying that in view of that, the assessing officer is requested to drop the panel, drop the initiation of this 148 notice, that is reopening. Friends, we all are aware that yes, the proviso to section 148 says that if the assessment is made under section 143.3, then subject to other conditions, one of the conditions is that if a true and full disclosure is made by the assessing in the financial statements or during his assessment proceedings, in that case, the reopening cannot be permitted. AO rejected this objection and he went ahead and he said that your objection is rejected because you have not disclosed these amounts that you have received from directors and relatives of the directors in your financial statements, one. Secondly, even in your 3C, me disclosure is not appearing. Thirdly, the margin money is reflected in the financial statements you have mentioned, but however, the list and LDT is not available on the record. The matter was disputed and it went to the High Court. The appellant, that is the petitioner, went to the High Court. High Court held that as submitted by the petitioner, margin money was reflected in Schedule 8 of the balance sheet. However, this is important, however, the submission is made before us for the first time. As in their objections to the reasons for reopening, the petitioner did not state that the loan amount mentioned in the reasons for reopening is nothing but margin money, which is reflected as margin deposit in Schedule 8. It is not open to the SSC to argue fresh objections before the court, which the assessing officer had no occasion to deal with. This objection was taken for the first time in the court. Just as the revenue cannot improve upon its case for reopening before the court, the same test would apply in the case of the SSC also, and the writ was dismissed. Friends, here we know that earlier we had the decision of Hindustan Lever. This is exactly the opposite. In that case, Hindustan Lever, I'll go through that, the finding of the court for the Hindustan Lever. So this is a case of a clear two-way cut, the sword cuts two-way, both the ways. Now what did the Hindustan Lever say? Hindustan Lever reported in 268 ITR 332, Bombay High Court again. Reasons are required to be read as they were recorded by the assessing officer. No addition, substitution or deletion is permissible. No reference, no inference can be allowed to be drawn based on reasons not recorded. The reasons recorded should be clear and unambiguous. It is for assessing officer to put his opinion on record in black and white. Reasons provide link between conclusion and evidence. The reasons recorded by the AO cannot be supplemented by filing affidavit or making oral submission. Otherwise, the reasons which were lacking in the material particulars would get supplemented by the time the matter reaches the court on the strength of affidavit or oral submissions advanced. So here in Hindustan Lever, what we have the findings of the court says that by way of an affidavit or any improvement cannot be allowed to be entertained. What is appearing at the time of the reasons recorded, only that will be read. Same way here also the court says that only that will be read. Here in Hindustan Lever it was allowed in favor of the SSC, here it is against, going against the SSC. The other observations in the case of Crown Consultancy, the last paragraph is important and more particularly that will be applicable in our day-to-day practice for the on account of the notices that we are receiving today. It reads like this. It is very likely that during the course of reassessment proceeding, the petitioner would be able to satisfy the assessing officer that the amount of ₹1.19 crore received in check by the petitioner from its directors and family members is nothing but margin money and stands reflected in Schedule 8 to the balance sheet. However, this would be a subject matter of reassessment proceeding. At this stage, we are only to examine whether or not there was a reasonable belief on the part of the assessing officer to come to a prima facie view that the income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. So friends, when we receive the notice, the assessing officer is only required to the extent to see that yes, he should have a reasonable belief, prima facie reasonable belief, to come to the conclusion that the income has escaped assessment, and thereafter he can proceed with the notice or with the reassessment proceedings. This brings me to the next decision, a small one.
This is reported in 362 ITR.
Yeah, I had in fact requested Dinesh Bhai and Sharma ji on Saturday that if they have the latest citation, they will please be given. It is reported in 362 ITR 368. Yeah. 362 ITR page 368. Part 3. Yeah. Okay. Coming to the next one. Here also, friends, the issue is about the proviso only, that is the applicability of the proviso. The notice was issued after the 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. Here it reads, where an assessment under section 143.3, or I am reading the relevant abstract of the proviso because that is important and that is very much applicable for our this decision. I quote, provided that where an assessment under subsection 3 of section 143 or this section has been made for the relevant assessment year, no action shall be taken under this section after the expiry of 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year unless 1. Any income chargeable to tax or escape assessment for such assessment year by reason of the failure on the part of the assessee to make a return under section 139. 2. Or in response to notice issued under subsection 142.3 or section 148 or 4, to disclose fully and truly all material facts necessary for your assessment for that assessment year. Here before the court, in other words, what did the court's finding is, in other words, the aforesaid notice, aforesaid conditions must reflect in the notice itself. In the absence of the same, exercise of jurisdiction in nuance of the notice under aforesaid provision is patently illegal. To draw an analogy, if a plaint does not disclose any cause of action in a suit, then such plaint is liable to be rejected. Similarly, if a complaint lodged under section 154 of the Code of Criminal Procedure does not disclose prima facie any cognizable offence, then such a complaint is liable to be squashed. I would see that majority of the notices which are issued does not mention these conditions, under which conditions do this notice fall. So this judgment would be very helpful and can be used wherever required.
I think Bombay High Court also says the same thing in German remedies this case.
In general, German
remedies, reasons itself they do not mention that there was failure.
That's the difference. In German remedies, it was the reasons under what it was. Here, the question is about the notice itself. The notice itself should mention that. The reasons will come after the notice.
Oh.
Here, it's talking about the notice itself. That is 148. Notice itself should mention this fact. I understand the notice is as known by saying it's cyclostyle. It is not, neither in the rules it is available nor it is been notified that it should be that. Only comprising the section, what is to be deleted and what is to be added, it has been done. But understanding that, what stops the condition? So reading this judgment, it will be very helpful judgment and one can keep it handy for them. The third judgment, this is a little bit long judgment as far as the findings are concerned and the facts are concerned. It's a BBC World News Limited. It pertains to assessment year 2003-04. Notice for scrutiny was issued on 30th March 2010. Here the dates are very important. Assessment was made under section 143, which is dated 24th March 2006. And during the assessment, it was holded that 20% of the global profit or loss is attributable to the PE associate in India on the proportionate or ratio of the Indian turnover versus the global turnover, and the same was assessed as loss of rupees 69 lakhs as against the nil income which was filed and thereafter which was revised showing as a loss of 69 lakhs. Assessing officer placed reliance on the order passed by the assessing by the CIT appeal of assessment year 2000-2001 in relation to BBC Worldwide, which is a group company of BBC World News. And on pursuing the records of the case, it is noticed that during the assessment proceedings, the actual expenditure incurred on the activities related to the Indian operations were not submitted by the SSC. And in assessment year 4-5 to assessment year 6-7, it was held that global loss, if any, is not on account of activity of the SSC which was carried out in India. Therefore, there was a different view taken in the CIT appeal for the earlier years as well as for the assessment year 2000-2001 for the group company, as what was assessed under the section 143(3) by the petitioner company. SSC's objection for reopening were on three grounds. One, that SSC had disclosed fully and truly all material facts because it was beyond 4 years again. Secondly, it is a case of change of opinion. And thirdly, reason to believe do not justify reopening. Assessing officer in the assessment proceedings had asked to furnish India-specific revenues and expenses, and those were submitted via letter dated 22nd March. This is one submission which has been very important throughout this judgment. While dismissing the objections of reopening, assessing officer mentioned that one letter dated 22nd March 2006 is neither on record nor was it mentioned in the assessment order. Assessment proceeding commenced on 31st May 2005 by issue of notice, yet the submission dated 22nd March 2006 running into 407 pages were filed just before passing the order which is dated 24th March 2006. Therefore, if at all, presuming he had filed, the SSC had filed, it cannot be termed as a full and true disclosure. B. If at all it is presumed to have been filed on 22nd March, order is passed on 24th March, therefore an AO to apply his mind after going through 407 pages is not possible. Therefore, since AO has not taken any opinion and no question of change of opinion will be applicable. To decide this controversy, the High Court allowed the SSC permitted to inspect the records of the assessment. SSC, after inspecting the records, SSC filed the affidavit which said, one, the assessment records were incomplete and papers were missing from the file. Two, the assessment record was not page numbered and neither was it indexed, which I don't think we do see it in our regular course also. Three, page numbers on documents were missing or were torn, and adhesive tapes were being used to stick the torn documents. Four, reply to notice issued under section 133(6), which was issued to some other party, third party, was on record, but there was no notice of 133(6) on the record. Five, it was alleged that revenue have reconstructed the original assessment record and there has been interpolation, manipulation and removal of papers to justify and make out the case for reopening and deny that submission dated 22nd March 2006 was not filed by the SSC. This is all was submitted by way of an affidavit to the court. SSC justifying that they had filed details of India specific revenue and expenditure during the original assessment by way of the following. This was a justification, in support to the justification. One, the assessment order does not record that details of India-specific income and expenditure were not filed. The assessment record does not suffer. Two, justification or reasons why the return of income was revised from nil to the loss was very clearly mentioned by way of two points in the disclosure of the return of income filed, revised return of income filed. Three, the assessing officer in earlier year in BBC Worldwide Limited has accepted the proportionate theory and assessed as loss in the same ratio, in the same proportion which was applicable to the Indian activities qua the global. The same assessing officer, the same person, has also passed the assessment order dated 24th March. Assessment order is detailed order incorporating activities carried out in and out of India, relevant observations from global audit report, and then it attributed 20% of loss to the SSEP. Next, fifth point, before passing the order, transfer pricing issue was referred to the TPO, who submitted his report on 7th March 2006. Audit objection further, audit objection by DD, Deputy Director General of Audit, was raised on the allowability and carry forward of loss. The said was replied by the assessing officer, justifying that assessing officer had allocated loss to Indian operations as per the provisions of Article 7 of the treaty. Revenue has not filed any affidavit of Mr. Saad Kidwani, the then assessing officer, who had conducted assessment proceedings to controvert and deny the contention that SSC had filed letter dated 22nd March 2006. And SSC was relying on CIT versus Usha International Full Banks reported in 348 ITR 485 Delhi. And it also relied on the another Delhi High Court decision for the change of opinion in the case of CIT versus Itcher Limited, reported in 294 ITR, page 310. Wherein, in these two judgments, just certain highlights of the judgments which will be very relevant, that's why I would like to read that. Wherein it says that the experience shows that the assessing of, this is a quote who's saying, the experience shows that the assessing officers do examine several aspects and raise queries, but when the written opinion is expressed in the form of the assessment order, there is no discussion or elucidation on certain aspects and issues decided or held in favor of the SSC. The SSC is not the author of the assessment order and has no control over the assessing officer wants to state or to mention. An SSC has no control over the way an assessment order is drafted. It was observed that generally the issues which are accepted by the AO do not find mention in the assessment order, and only such points are taken note on which the SSC's explanations are rejected or additions or disallowances are made. Court, that is the Bombay High Court, on all the three grounds held that reopening, sorry, this is the Delhi High Court, sir. So Delhi High Court on all the three grounds held that the reopening was not valid. There is, first, there is no live link of income escaping assessment. Secondly, it is a change of opinion. And thirdly, full and true disclosure is made in the revised return. Further, it is also noted that it is not practice of the department to give acknowledgement of papers submitted during the course of assessment proceedings. The court has not accepted the argument of respondent and observed that the petitioner is not the author of the assessment order and could not have dictated or directed how the assessment order should be written. The AO is the author, had to decide what he wants to record and what he wants to mention in the assessment order. It did not stop here. It thereafter said that this copy of the order should be sent to the chairman of the CVDT, for appropriate and necessary action to ensure proper record maintenance and issuance of the suitable directions. This judgment, friends, would give us a clue that wherever required, we should take an inspection of the records. There should be no hesitation in taking inspection of the record. And in the lighter vein, I would say that when the lights are still on in the Aayakar Bhavan after 6 o'clock in the month of April, then it is normally said that possibly they would be weeding out certain files. They would be putting their records online. They would be setting their files as per the requirement of the law. This all would help us for our further arguments before CIT appeal and the tribunal. And if required, an affidavit can also be filed mentioning what all were missing. So this brings me
this 362 ITR 577.
Yeah, here the citation comes.
362 ITR 577.
Okay. Thank you, Sharma ji.
Yes, sir.
The next judgment that, friends, I am looking for is not reported in the handout that I have given. It is Philip Bhai who brought to my notice, and we thought that yes, it is worth discussing this forum. Is Tissue Match Products India Private Limited versus ACIT. Sorry, this I have already covered. It's SN Bhargava versus ITO Mathura. It's not given in the handout. So that's why I'm writing, I'm telling the full name. SN Bhargava versus Income Tax Officer Mathura and reported in 147 ITD page 306. The relevant assessment year is 98-99. Assessing Officer Agra had initiated reassessment proceedings for information received regarding bogus claim of long-term capital gain. You know that even in Bombay we had received quite a few for long-term capital gain. The reopenings were done and the matters are still pending before the tribunal. SSC filed reply that he was filing return of income with the assessing officer Mathura, hence notice under section 148 is wrong and incorrect. Assessing officer Agra transferred the file to assessing officer Mathura. Assessing officer Mathura, on the basis of the reasons recorded by the assessing officer Agra, proceeded and issued fresh notice under section 148 and passed the assessment order. Tribunal held it was a borrowed satisfaction, which is not sufficient to confer power on the assessing officer to initiate reassessment proceedings. Assessing officer Agra did not have jurisdiction. Therefore, he should not have recorded the reasons for reopening. And further, he did not examine any information supplied by the DDI investigation, and that he was having no reasons to believe that income chargeable to tax had escaped assessment. I will repeat, friends, the tribunal had further, he did not examine any information supplied by the DDIT investigation, which today normally assessing officer for these bogus purchases are receiving information from DDIT. If that is not further examined, if they do not put proper records or simply issuing the notice that I have received the information of DDIT and I want to reopen, would not be sufficient. The assessing officer Mathura, without recording fresh reasons, merely followed the reasons recorded by ITO Agra. Hence, he had no satisfaction of escaped income. Therefore, proceedings under section 147 is bad in law and against the provisions of law. This is, friends, similar to the judgment which we have of Rajasthan High Court in the case of Rajasthan Syntex Limited, reported in 313 ITR 231, and which was confirmed by the Supreme Court dismissing SLP of department, which is reported in 313 ITR, statute page 27. This brings me again to our list circulated in the handout on the second subject of section 199. Here also, friends, we have a set of three judgments. The first one is Citicorp Finance India Limited. The facts in brief are: SSC had claimed 16.52 crore in by way of TDS in the original return of income. Thereafter, the claim was further increased by 1.43 crore in the revised return of income filed by the SSC, and thereafter further increased during the assessment proceedings by 3.56 crore, and that aggregated to 21.51 crore. The assessing officer gave the credit of TDS only to the tune of 11.89 crore. The SSC disputed the matter with CIT appeal, and the CIT appeal passed the order directing the SSC to furnish all TDS certificate in original before the assessing officer, who was further directed to verify the claim of credit of TDS and to allow TDS as per original challenge available on record or as per the details of such TDS available on computer system today, we very well know, which is in the form of 26 AS. Aggrieved by this order of CIT appeal, the SSC went to the tribunal. The tribunal observed that the credit of TDS has been denied to the SSC on the ground that the claim for TDS was reflected in the computer generated form 26 AS, was not reflected in the computer generated in the form 26 AS. The difficulty faced by the taxpayer in the matter of credit of TDS has been considered by the Honorable Bombay High Court in the case of Yashpal Swane versus DCIT, reported in 293 ITR, page 539, in which it was held that even if the deductor had not issued TDS certificate, the claim of the SSC has to be considered on the basis of evidence produced for deduction of tax at source, as the revenue was empowered to recover the tax from the person responsible if he had not deducted tax at source, or after deducting he had failed to deposit to the central government. Honorable Delhi High Court, in the case of its own motion versus CIT, reported in 352 ITR, page 273, have also directed the department to ensure that credit is given to the SSC where deductor had failed to upload the correct details in form 26 AS on the basis of evidence produced before the department. Therefore, the department is required to give credit for TDS once valid TDS certificate had been produced, or even where the deductor had not issued TDS certificates on the basis of evidence produced by the SSC regarding deduction of tax at source and on the basis of indemnity bond. So, putting both these two decisions of Bombay High Court and Delhi High Court, we can very well conclude that if the SSC is in a position to show that, look, on X amount my TDS has been deducted, in that case it should be allowed. It may have to be followed by way of an indemnity bond given to given to the assessing officer.
But payment is not required.
Yeah, I appreciate that this question. I was expecting this question to come. That even if the payment is not made, whether it will be still allowed. Now, if we have to read section 199, in that case, it is very clearly saying that it will be allowed only if the payment has been made by the deductor. Section 205 says that no recovery can be made once the taxes have been deducted. Section 199 says that the credit will be allowed where the taxes have been deducted and deposited. So if a plain reading of the section is to be done, then I would say that yes, the credit will not be allowed. However, as we read, the Bombay High Court as well as the Delhi High Court, they both say that the recovery procedure is available with the assessing officer, and that can be recovered once the taxes are deducted. Even if they have not been deposited, the recovery can be made from the deductor. So understanding that ratio, I would say that this judgment, applying this judgment, the credit should be allowed. Yeah. I am not referring, the court is referring. Well, what we can debate that evidence to show that, for example, here in the Yashpal Sawhney's case, it was a salary employee. He was an employee of the company. So the pay slips were available, which very clearly mentioned that, look, the taxes have been deducted. Same way, if it's in the case of an interest or a contract, wherever there is some confirmation available and the evidence of your bank statement, and if the confirmation also says that yes, this is the X amount which has been paid to you by way of an interest after deducting the TDS amount.
So bank's covering letter will help.
Yeah, covering letter will also help. Covering letter will also help.
After deducting so and so. Only bank statement will suffice?
I don't think so. Bank statement would give you the proof that yes, this is the check that you have received. But how do you say that it is after deduction of the TDS? So for that, either you require a covering letter or a confirmation or some evidence to show that the gross amount was this and after deducting TDS, I have received the net amount. Sorry? Same thing, it can be applied. Any confirmation?
The agreement after deducting this percentage, which is applicable for the
absolutely.
This is the amount received.
Yeah, yeah.
So there is an element of TDS.
Right, yeah.
It should be applied to the
PE,
not to the payer. Like,
bar
against the PE to
the 205 is for the payee. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Once the taxes have been deducted of the payee, in that case, no recovery can be made. So, however, the notice of demand, your credit will not be allowed and the demand will be created, and the notice of demand will be issued saying that this is the outstanding amount which the department wants to recover from you. You can make an application to show that this is the amount of TDS which has already been deducted. In that case, the department cannot recover that amount which has been displayed by way of the notice of demand. Yeah. Now coming to the rule, that is 37BA, what you are referring to, the relevant rule is 37BA. Okay, I think at this juncture, first of all, let us read section 199 subsection 1 prior to amendment and after amendment and the relevant portion of rule 37A, and thereafter we go to the next judgment. Friends, 199 subsection 1. Prior to the amendment, that is prior to 1/4/2008, which said credit shall be given for the amount so deducted, blah blah blah, for the assessment year for which such income is assessable. This is on the point of the word assessable. And after 1/4/2008, Section 199, subsection 3, which reads that the board may, for the purpose of giving credit, make such rules as may be necessary, including blah blah blah, for the assessment year for which such credit may be given. And the relevant rule, and it said that the CBDT will be prescribing the rule. Now, the rules are prescribed after a year. So, virtually for 1 year, there was no law applicable as far as the credit is to be given. But we understand that it reverts back when the rules are not framed. The rule, which came with effect from 1/4/2009, sub-rule 3.1 says that credit for tax deducted at source and paid to the central government shall be given for the assessment year for which such income is assessable. That is sub-rule 3. The another rule, two rules. First rule says that it should have been claimed by the payee. Second says that the payer should have reflected, what you are saying is that payer should have reflected that by informed that by way of his TDS returns or quarterly statements that we so call it. So unless the taxes are deducted and deposited, the payer will not be in a position to submit his quarterly statements. So strictly applying the rule, unless all these three conditions, number one, I will repeat, that the payer, that is the assessor, should have claimed that TDS amount in his return of income. Number two, the payee, that is a deductor, the payer, that is a deductor, should have uploaded correct details by way of his quarterly TDS statement. And number three, the income should have been assessed the year in which it is required to be assessable. So these three are the conditions. After fulfilling these three conditions, as per rule 337BA, the credit will be allowed. Now coming to our next two judgments, which are on our serial number 5. It is Visakhapatnam bench and it is ACIT Vijayawada versus the SSE. The SSE's name is not disclosed, however the pen number is available on that order. Here the issue was, the TDS was not allowed on the mobilization advance received by the SSE. The SSE used to adjust this mobilization advance received against the work bill certificate during the year and did not form part of the gross contracts credited to the profit and loss account. So these advances which were received in year 1 were adjusted in year 2 or 3 later on. In the year 1, this was not reflected as a gross receipt of the SSE. The assessing officer denied the credit. That look, your income, as we have just now seen, the sub-rule 3.1, which says that it will be, which says that credit for the deducted, for credit for tax deducted at source and paid to the central government shall be given for the assessment year for which such income is assessable. Now here in our example that we are discussing, the income was either assessable in year 2 or 3. The in year 1 the income was not assessable because this was treated as an advance by the SSE. Therefore the credit was denied. The SSE explained that mobilization advance could be adjusted against the subcontracts bill in the subsequent years. The assessing officer was saying that it could be either adjusted or refunded in the subsequent years, and therefore he did not allow the credit of the relevant TDS amount. The assessing officer was of the view that credit of TDS is allowed as per the provisions of section 199 in the assessment year in which relatable income is assessable. Since the corresponding income is not assessable in the imputed assessment year, the credit of TDS cannot be allowed to the SSC. Now comes the CIT appeal also dismiss the appeal of the SSC, the matter traveled to the tribunal. The tribunal's observations are, according to the pre-amended provisions of section 199, that is prior to 1499, the credit of deduction made in accordance with the relevant provision of this chapter and paid to the central government shall be given for the amount so deducted on the production of the certificate furnished under section 203 of the assessment made under this act for the assessment year for which such income is assessable. But in the amended provisions, the word for the assessment year for which such income is assessable has been omitted, meaning thereby that the legislature was quite conscious about the facts and hardship faced by the SSC. And thereafter it said that because of this deletion, that in the year in which it should be assessable is not there in the act anymore in the section 199. The credit should be allowed the year in which the taxes have been deducted. This is what this judgment says, and the appeal was allowed in favor of the SSC. Before I give my observations, let us go through the another judgment of Sadbhav Engineering Limited. Here also, friends, they have, this is of the Bombay, this is of Ahmedabad Tribunal. It's an Ahmedabad tribunal. Friends, here they have done nothing but simply followed this judgment of Visakhapatnam. And second reason given is that since the learned DR could not cite any contrary decision, the credit was allowed in the year 1 on the advances that were received. Coming to the next judgment, before coming to the next judgment, friends, as we read the observation of after deletion and the amended provision of section 199, which said that a rule will be framed, will be notified, and as per the rule, these wordings, identical wordings of income assessable, credit will be allowed in the year in which the income is assessable, are existing. Possibly this was not brought to the notice of the tribunal, that is why this judgment is in favor of the SSC. Irrespective of that, I think this judgment will be helpful because it's not only one, it's Visakhapatnam, thereafter it is Gujarat, Ahmedabad tribunal also, saying that wherever such cases are there, if the credit is to be, very technically and legally speaking, I would have my own reservations, but otherwise we can use this judgment for our benefit. I am trying to distinguish the word accessible and how much it should be accessible by way of the another judgment which is on our serial number 6, which is of PK Mangla and Associates. Is a chartered accountant, that is a professional firm, which will be directly applicable to our own cases. Here, friends, the SSC was following cash basis of accounting and payer was following mercantile system. SSC had accounted the TDS amount as income and claimed the benefit of TDS. The TDS amount was accounted as an income and which was claimed as a credit of the TDS. Though not coming from the order, but I understand that SSC wanted to comply with the provisions of section 198, that is about the deemed income of TDS. I understand many firms do not follow this practice. They account income in the year in which they account the income in the year in which the amount of the fees are received and the credits are claimed. And that has been approved and the credit will be allowed in the year in which the income is considered, accounted, and the proportionate credit will be allowed. The proportionate credit will be allowed is followed by the decision of third member Chandigarh bench, Pradeep Kumar Dheer and CIT, reported in 109 TTJ page 445. The Bombay Tribunal third member reported in 98 ITD page 147, Varsha G. Salunke. There the tribunal held that the entire amount of the TDS will be allowed once the income is assessable, not the proportion. Say for example, if in the second year, year one, I assume the TDS is deducted as per the provisions made in the books of account by the payer, the professional firm, say the chartered accountant firm, received 50% of the fees in year two. In that case, following the Chandigarh bench, the only proportionate credit, that is the 50% of the amount of the TDS, will be allowed. Following Bombay Tribunal, the entire amount will be allowed. And following the Visakhapatnam and Ahmedabad Tribunal, the entire amount can be allowed in year one. Now, the question comes that how do we reconcile all this? To that, even I don't have an answer. Possibly what Delhi High Court has said and what the other high courts, I would say, would definitely follow, including the Bombay High Court, which says that an indemnity bond and certain evidence to show that taxes have been deducted, possibly it would help. I have, just one second, I have small reservations. I don't understand. Here in PK Mangla, they were accounting the TDS amount. I still would understand that if the TDS amount was taken in the computation, not in the books of account. Accounting, if you are following cash system of accounting, I don't understand how you can account that income of the TDS amount. Except for the section 198, deemed to have been received for the income tax purpose. Now, it's 198 is a procedural part. It is not a charging section. Any income to be charged, there has to be a charging section. Now, this cannot become a charge. And 198 talks about that, yes, it's a deeming section. It's an income of the SSE, but of which year? That it does not say. Wherever required, the law says that it will be the income of the previous year when the taxes have been deducted. So, to that extent, I would say that the Bombay Tribunal and Chandigarh Tribunal are more rational judgments, and however, as you discussed, these are favorable judgments, so we are discussing for our academic purpose. Yeah, something.
The TDS is income deemed to be deductible,
what I am saying. Technically, also, don't claim. It's really difficult because it's
paid in the subsequent
year.
In the respective module of TDS, there is a column, what is the amount of tax deducted and what is the amount of tax claimed. So either you can put nil and thereafter you can say that it was claimed in the subsequent year. Sorry?
For showing the TDS, when you make again an active case that it is not given a credit, then you will have to show the previous year.
I did not understand your query, because that means little more.
See, in the first year TDS is deducted. You are claiming on the year of receipt, right? And the receipt of income. Now in that year, because of credit, it will not appear in your TCAS.
Credit will not allow. I appreciate.
You apply for a rectification. You will give again a total list of TDS.
In such cases, wherever the credits are not reflected in your 26 years, you should not apply to CPC. Rectification should not be made to CPC. It should be directly made to the assessing officer. Why will they not give reply? That's the procedural problem. But however, number one, they cannot reject your 154. They cannot even say that I will not accept. I understand that some nuisance value would be there. Maybe seniors have to go to even file your 154 application as against our clerks and who used to go. How can they say they don't have jurisdiction?
Any assessing payment
scrutiny notice was issued. Can the assessing officer say that I don't have the jurisdiction? No. won't by the jurisdiction still remains with your assessing officer. If jurisdiction doesn't change year wise.
They
may not carry out the rectification till they receive the refund, till they receive the return from the CPC. I would understand that. That to that extent I can understand, but they cannot refuse.
Yes sir, there is CBDT circular also, in instruction also, they have to accept any paper. I have 31st March, I have asked them to accept.
Okay, so this is an update, that the assessing officer can call the written. So it does not mean the jurisdiction, it does not mean that after receiving the return, supposing the return of income is not filed, does the assessing officer have a jurisdiction to issue a notice that you have not filed your return of income? Simple. So return of income has no connection with the jurisdiction. Whether it is filed, it is not filed. I appreciate practically, and that's the reason why we are all gathered here, so that we can be, you know, educated more.
I will break it for our meeting notes. So we have with us Mandal Director, you will take up the meeting.
Very good evening, friends. The maxim that I propose to discuss today is active personalis moritur cum persona, which means personal action dies with the person. To give a very simple example, if some criminal is being tried for some crime and during the pendency of the proceedings if the criminal dies, can the action be pursued against his legal heirs? Answer is quite obviously no. Because in criminal proceedings, the action does not survive the offender. In civil proceedings, the rule is slightly different. In civil proceedings, this particular maxim actually has to be read along with another maxim, which says actio contra defectum coteta continuata, which means an action commenced against a person deceased transmits against his heirs. That means in civil proceedings, the action can be continued against the legal heirs, but of course that cannot be a criminal action, it can only be a civil action, because even a vicarious liability, there cannot be anything called as a criminal vicarious liability. Vicarious liability is always a civil liability. Now, even in civil proceedings, there are certain exceptions, but in civil proceedings, certain actions cannot survive neither the offender nor the aggrieved party. If any one of the person dies, the action has to stop over there. Now, those kind of actions are where relief is sought against the person, that particular person. For example, defamation. If an offender defames someone and the offender dies, then the plaintiff, that is the person who is aggrieved, he cannot claim any action against the legal heirs of the offender. Because the action was against the person, against the personal act of the offender, and therefore this particular action cannot survive the offender. However, this does not apply in case of any obligations on the basis of a contract or debt or covenant. In those cases, the action will survive the offender, the action can be pursued against the legal heirs. So here, what is the test to be applied? That is, what are the actions that will get continued against the legal heirs, and what are the actions which will abate? A very simple test was laid down by the English court in Phillips versus Humphrey, which was followed by the Bombay High Court in Haridas Ramdas versus Ramdas Mathuradas. They held that while the action of the defaulter benefits the estate of the defaulter, in such cases the action will continue against the heir. If there is no benefit to the estate of the defaulter, then the action cannot continue. So, for example, in the case of official liquidator versus P.A. Pendulkar, that was a Supreme Court decision reported in 1973, first volume SCC page 602. In that case, the director of a company was tried for misrepresentation and breach of trust. During the pendency of the proceedings, the director died. And the official liquidator desired to continue the action against the legal heirs. The legal heirs objected to the same, and the matter is the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court held that, see, misrepresence or breach of trust are not cases where this particular maxim will apply. This is a case where the personal estate of the offender has definitely benefited out of the action of the particular offender, and therefore the action can continue against the legal heir. So this particular test led down by the Bombay High Court and the English Court in Phillips versus Humphrey was confirmed by the Supreme Court, where they held that this maxim will have no application where the wealth or the estate of the offender has benefited because of the action of the offender. So that is what this this particular maxim means, that is actio personalis moritur cum persona, which has to derive along with this another maxim, actio contra de factum coperta continuator, which means an action commenced against a person deceased transmits against the legal heirs. So the simple application, in as much as criminal proceedings are concerned, the criminal proceedings have to abide at the point of time where the accused dies. And as much as criminal proceedings are concerned, the criminal proceedings will continue against the legal heirs, with this particular exception that if the offender's action has had any impact on the estate of the offender, then this particular action cannot continue against the legal heirs. And the same applies in case of administrator as well as the executors, because the Bombay High Court has held that the executors and the administrator do not represent the offender, they represent the estate of the offender. And therefore, unless and until there is an impact on the estate of the offender, the action cannot continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Madhav bhai. Friends, I thank on behalf of chamber, Madhav bhai has taken us to the legal term which we will not pronounce, and he has explained us in a very lucid manner with the help of examples and the referring to the various judgments. I request now Madhav bhai to take up the floor.
Thank you, Madhav bhai. I was just referring whether this will be helpful for our prosecutions.
Yes,
prosecution.
So it will be very helpful.
Yes,
right?
Yes, prosecution cannot continue if both the parties,
as you said, one of the parties is not there. Now, normally the prosecutions are launched, the commissioner or whoever is supposed to be there.
Correct.
So the prayer would be the saying that why should not the commissioner? No, it's said that even after the commissioners are transferred, they are supposed to be present again in the court.
No, but here
either of the party.
According, as I said, sir, the question of the prosecutor, that is the department dying, will not arise. Department dying will not arise.
Because
you see, the commissioner is not the real complainant. The complainant is the department.
No, but Manda, I remember one of the commissioner said, one of my department, I have to be present in the prosecution, is one by me. Now I think there is a change in the rules.
Yeah, we have a commissioner, retired commissioner. Let us see from
the person who has filed that prosecution. I think that prosecution will continue even if he is not there. The all the material and everything will be there.
So it's unfortunate.
He has to come there, possibly to the lead evidence. That is the difference.
From the charges. At the time of formation of the
charges. Formation of the charges, that's the difference.
He is the person who has signed that complaint and all those things. So he has. He may be summoned to just affirm as to what he is saying in light and all those things. So at least for the first and the second time, he might have to come.
Not for the documentary wise.
No.
But of course, if the offender, the SSC, if he dies, then the judge, but the department, the prosecutor dying, does not arise.
Okay, I think thanks for highlighting these issues. The next judgment is a set on recovery. Of course, I understand that March is over, but these judgments will show the high-handedness of the department. At least that is one of the reason why I want to bring this to the notice of the August audience. It's Amul Research and Development Association, Gujarat High Court. Friends, we all are aware that the statutory period of 30 days are allowed from the date of service of notice under section 220, the notice which is issued by our demand notice under section 156. So as per section 220, 30 days are to be allowed. However, there is a proviso to first subsection which says that this 30 days can be reduced where the assessing officer has reason to believe that it will be detrimental to revenue if 30 days are allowed with the previous approval of the joint commissioner. Now friends, I would read from the relevant portion from the order. The words, as we read the proviso, it says reason to believe. The word reason to believe must have the same flavor as one finds in the case of exercise of powers by a reasonable man acting in good faith with objectivity and neutrality based on material on record or exhibited in the order itself. The prior permission of the superior officer, that is the JC, is to ensure that the powers are not exercised arbitrarily and there is a safeguard of a higher officer applying his mind independently to the issue in the question when such belief is communicated to the assessing officer. Here, the notice of demand dated March 13, 2013 was issued. A period of 7 days was granted to the SSA for payment of a total sum of 1.41 crore instead of a statutory period of 30 days. The reason given for the reduction of the period for payment of tax was that the SSA's place of assessment there was a budget deficit in the income tax department. It was the budget deficit which was the very basis for making such a formation of belief. Another reason given was that the SSC had a rich cash flow and if the period of 30 days was reduced, the budget deficit would be met and the target set by the department would be achieved. Admittedly, such permission of the Joint Commissioner had come subsequent to the communication of reduction of the period for payment of tax. While issuing notice to the bank under Section 226, Subsection 3 of the Act for making payment, a notice has also to be given to the SSE, which in this case was on the very day when the notice was issued to the bank. At times we see the notices are issued either simultaneously or the notice is first issued to the bank and thereafter it is served on the assessing to the SSC, which in this case was the very same day when the notice was issued to the bank. No opportunity had been given to the SSC for meeting such a notice issued to the bank. The sizable amount of 1.39 crores had been withdrawn and deposited in the account of the revenue on the very same day. Notice was an illusory and empty formality. So here the tribunal's observation is number one, that there is a reason to believe. And it should be a natural reason. It cannot be a reason that my target is not met or this and that, or maybe tomorrow he says I was going out of India so I wanted to recover it and thereafter I was going. All those nonsenses will not be allowed. It should be that the SSC, it should be detrimental to the revenue, that in case if this notice of 30 days is allowed, either he would run away. Here we have seen, observed that notices of years and months have been allowed, they don't run away. They are still sitting in our Rajya Sabhas. Then there is a question. Secondly, a notice when it is issued to the bank under Section 226, simultaneously a notice should, if at all issued, to the SSC, then the attachment, the bank account only should be attached. You are not supposed to withdraw the amount so that the SSC can present his case and he can have his own arguments whether the amount should not be withdrawn or what he wants to offer by way of any security or any stay petition which is pending, or he can make his case out of it. This is what I wanted to bring to your notice, that if a regular just a direction to meet with the requirement and reducing this notice, and I have observed that certain commissioner had orally given instructions to the assessing officer that it was like a blanket permit that you please reduce, not please, you reduce the period of 30 days to 7 days and start the action of recovery immediately once the 7 days are over. In such cases, this would be a very good case as far as our SSC is concerned. Okay. The second one is AT Kearney India Private Limited. This is a small judgment. I just wanted to bring out certain important point. That's why I covered this judgment. Despite the stay granted by the tribunal, the respondent, that is the SSC, the accounts were attached and took away the proceedings from the bank account. The counselor for the revenue contends that there was no intimation about the stay and the concerned assessing officer was not present when the tribunal granted the stay. So here, because that the stay was granted, there was some delay in informing to the assessing officer. The amount was withdrawn in between the period of the stay granted and the notice or the information or the order was given to the assessing officer. There is a High Court observation. If such an argument is made before this court, that is the High Court, where orders are pronounced in court in the presence of counsel, it would certainly not be accepted and in fact would be seriously viewed. In the facts of this case, it clearly amounts to overreach in the interim order of the tribunal. In a similar situation, this court itself would possibly be initiating contempt proceedings. So it's indirectly trying to say that if this would have been a case before the High Court, the contempt proceedings would have been initiated on the assessing officer. The tribunal, I am not much aware, I tried to just find out whether the tribunal, in such cases the tribunal can also issue contempt proceedings. We have few lawyers over here. Whether the tribunal can also issue contempt proceedings in such a cases or not, or at least after reading this order the tribunals become active, whether if at all you can say that yes, it's a contempt course. One of the court advocates says that no, that
I don't think so, because tribunal does not have the power to go for contempt.
I also give a penalty. I think one of the CIT DR was penalty by 1000 rupees in Delhi tribunal.
That could be the cost of the penalty,
this is amount for contempt proceeding, so you are
the tribunal ordered.
Yeah, tribunal order, and you pay from your pocket 1000 rupees fine. CIT DR.
For contempt, actually they have to inform to the High Court to take appropriate proceedings against them.
So then what stopped the High Court? They should have said that they should have not then they should have done that only when they are saying that the tribunal should have done anyway.
The point here is that the officials are not accountable. Even if 1000 rupees collect is very, it doesn't serve the purpose. The SS is to the internal financial hardship, not only that his consultant is also to lot of mental hardship.
The consultant has accepted that hardship for whatever reason, so he's put it to that hardship.
That's his choice.
That was, he had a choice, not the SSC. The question, see, I appreciate the judgments that friends I have been referring to also. Ultimately, if you see, the SSC is the loser. Whatever the department wanted, the courts have also said that within 2 weeks, within 1 week, within 10 days, you make the payment. And all those dates are coming after 1st April. So the financial year or the target, whatever they wanted to achieve or whatever they wanted to do, is served. Every year we have been having these decisions of high courts. Every year. Unfortunately, still the department either takes it lightly that okay, when High Court comes, theek hai, mun niche karke sun lene ka, and we carry out our same high-handedness. I will again refer to this, another judgment that I have been taking is on DIT exemption, Bombay High Court. This is a case of a Mahada. Mahada is an SSC. In assessment year, assessing officer denied SSC exemption under section 11 and the demand of rupees 199 crore was raised. SSC preferred appeal before CIT appeal and simultaneously it made a stay petition before the assessing officer. before the assessing officer against the stay petition, the installments are granted, and within 10 installments the entire amount of 1.99 CR was to be paid. After making the payment of first installment, the SSC moved High Court. The SSC moved to the moved an application to the commissioner. The commissioner reduced that installment from 10 installments to 7 installments. It was spread over more hour because the first installment had already been paid, and thereafter it had reduced the amount that has to be paid in the number of installments. Against that, the SSC went to the High Court. No, against the CIT appeals stay order, which was conditional stay order that you need to pay by these installments, the SSC went to the High Court by way of a writ. The writ had no outcome, it was kept pending only. In the meanwhile, the CIT appeal dismissed the appeal of the SSC on 29-10-2013. The dates here are, I would say, not only the dates, the timings are also very important. The CIT appeal dismissed the appeal by the order dated 29th October 2013, which was served on the SSC on 16-11-2013, and 16-11 happened to be a Saturday. On 11th November, assessing officer, that is before the order was received, the assessing officer issued recovery notice to pay by 15th of November 2013 the outstanding demand. SSC pointed out that they had not received CIT appeals order and they would be filing appeal and a stay before the tribunal. However, assessing officer rejected the prayer and directed to pay by 15th November 2013. Here, SSC had drawn attention by way of that application that we have not received, they had drawn attention of the Bombay High Court decision in the case of UTI Mutual Fund reported in 345 ITR page 71 that no recovery can be made till the disposal of the stay application before the ITAT, and no coercive proceedings should be taken till the period of filing appeal expires. That is what Bombay High Court in the case of UTI has given. Now, immediately on receipt of the order of CIT appeal, SSC preferred appeal and stay application to tribunal and filed on 18-11-2013. 16th, they had received the CIT appeals order, which was a Saturday. On 18th, they had filed the appeal to the tribunal with the stay application, and the hearing was fixed on 22nd November 2013. On 18th November, assessing officer attached the bank account and withdrew the amount of 1.59 CR. Tribunal heard the stay petition and directed to refund the entire amount of 1.59 CR. Department preferred appeal before High Court, saying since there was no demand outstanding, because it was already recovered on 18th. Since there was no demand outstanding, the stay could not be granted and the tribunal had no power to order the refund of the amount, because the grievance was against the stay of the demand. Now, where is the demand once I have already collected? Hold there, half an hour. Since the application was for the stay of demand, as I said, High Court held there is no bar on the tribunal from restoring the status quo ante as existing on 18-11-2013 and ordered revenue to refund ₹159.84 crores to the SSC. They referred to the judgment of East India Commercial Company versus Collector of Customs reported in AIR 1962, Supreme Court, page 1893. Secondly, revenue and assessing officer remember that we live in a state which is governed by rule of law. It is primary obligation of the officers of the state that it follows the law laid down by the courts in letter and spirit before taking any coercive action. During the assessment, during the hearing, one of the argument that on 18-11, when the appeal was filed and the stay application was filed before the tribunal, the stay application was filed at 3:30 and the inspector had already attached the amount, attached the bank account at 12 noon and withdrawn that amount. So following the UTI also, they cannot withdraw, first of all. Secondly, the dispute by way of an affidavit, it did come out saying that no, he had not, after consulting the bank officers, no, he had not withdrawn this amount and the attachment was not made before 3:30. Prior to that, already the stay application was filed. So I think now the bankers or the tribunal, they should start giving an acknowledgement saying that yes, this is the time when your application has been accepted. Because if at all the tribunal's observation or the SSC is saying that there was nothing outstanding, then this time becomes very relevant. At 3:30, when the stay petition is filed, at that time, if the amount is not withdrawn or the notice is not issued under Section 226, at that time there is an outstanding amount, the stay needs to be entertained. So this is what, how the officers' high-handedness, and here also as we see, ultimately it was said that no, the revenue is supposed to refund the amount within 2 weeks, and that 2 weeks was after 31st of March. So ultimate the purpose of the assessing officer or the department is fulfilled. And they had referred to the judgment again. In this judgment, they had referred to the Bombay High Court, both the judgments, that is KEC International, reported in 251 ITR. It says that they are supposed to follow the norms, the procedure, what has been spelled out in the judgment of KEC International, reported in 251 ITR, page 158, Bombay High Court.
Sir, for such instances, can you not represent officers accountable? Like, accountable to the first.
Why only for stay and recovery that they should be accountable? We have been saying this accountability number of times. Lastly, in last representation, we have made it very clear, Chambers representation I am saying, that we had made it very clear that why you are moving into computerization, why all the proceedings should not be computerized and uploaded on the site. When we can view 26 AIS by password and login, let the proceedings also be viewed by the necessary officers and the higher ups also. So at least those adjustments and all this, that transparency, I don't know, for whatever reason, they are not inclined. It's not that whoever is the minister at the helm of it, he is not aware about these judgments. They are very well aware. In spite of that, when he said in writing, if it is put up that he wanted to achieve his quota, and because of achieving his quota, he had done this high-handedness.
Actually, sir, finance minister, they are laying down quota.
Yeah, I appreciate it. It's the finance minister who is.
Should not be blamed. They should pay.
The chief commissioners are saying, they are calling big corporates wherever there is a shortfall. And they are saying that you please make the payment of advance tax and we will see to it that you will get a refund very soon. When they are very well aware about it, that what they can get a refund. Here the assessing officer, whether he has a jurisdiction is a question mark when it is raised. There is a question of sending a refund. It's ultimately CPC is going to send the refund. What do they have? And until the assessing file is return of income, how are you going to send the refund? So it is patent, I would say, false promises that are given by the higher authorities. But somehow we are staying in the, as the court said, we are staying in the state where the law is to be maintained, and somehow it is not been maintained. So now let us hope some new government comes and something better proceeds. I am not advocating any government from this forum. Okay. UTI in that.
Orders which are passed pursuant to the direction of DRP, those orders have to be challenged directly before the ITA. And you have a time limit of 2 months for filing up to the ITA. And as per 228, the time limit of 30 days will expire. So the point is that is the rule, so which means that these people cannot hit government. Okay, there will be 220 implications that maybe for a month.
I understand the interest would be definitely, that's his procedural part, and yeah, they should not be able to, yeah, applying this UTI, yes, it should not be, I agree with you. Okay, another judgment brings me to is on rectification. Now friends, I will go a little fast because I have to keep a check on the time also. It is regarding the rectification where the intimation is issued under section 143, which said that it cannot be rectified under section 154. The facts are SSC filed return of income of assessment year 5-6 declaring rupees 54 lakhs as income on account of waiver of interest by the creditor. That is under section 41-1. That time assessment proceedings of assessment year 4-5 were pending, wherein this interest expenditure was claimed. Assessing officer in assessment year 4-5 disallowed the claim and SSC did not prefer appeal, and neither he filed the revised return of income for assessment year 5-6. Department computed tax payable based on the return of income filed for assessment year 5-6, and some nominal demand was raised maybe on account of some calculation or some credit not allowed. The SSC filed rectification application under section 154, which was rejected by the assessing officer, saying there is no mistake apparent from the record. He moved to the CIT appeal. CIT appeal allowed this rectification and said that it should be carried out. However, when the department went to the tribunal, the tribunal rejected. And now we have the High Court over here, a Kerala High Court, which says, intimation under section 143 would be sent at the relevant point of time only in case there was refund of excess tax that is paid or there is a shortfall in the tax. Because we have that intimation is not mandatory, only in these two circumstances the intimation is required to be sent. Otherwise the acknowledgement becomes your intimation. This was a case of shortfall on account of some tax payment. And this shortfall was calculated properly and correctly based on the return declared by the SSC. Therefore, there was no mistake or error apparent on the face of record in the intimation sent by the department indicating the exact shortfall of tax to be paid. The mistake on the part of the SSC is not challenging the assessment order. The mistake in part of the SSC in not challenging the assessment order for the assessment year 4-5 and not filing a revised return for assessment year 5-6 had led the SSC to this situation. The entire difficulty in which the SSC was put was on account of his own mistake, which could not be treated as a mistake apparent on the face of the record so far as the intimation sent by the department, and it could not be rectified treating it as a mistake in the intimation of the department. So a precaution, my dear friends, that one needs to take care when either you should prefer an appeal in the higher ups or revise the return of income for assessment year 5-6 if you have missed that bus. However, I understand that there could have been another way out by 263 also if the time was allowed. Within 263 he could have made this, but otherwise you have missed the bus. So whatever High Court has said, you have literally interpreted the provisions of section 154.
264
yeah. So that was, that could have been possible. 10th, no? 11th. Sorry, 11th, yeah. Now this is something, this is again very interesting judgment which has come to Bombay Tribunal. first of all, because of short of time, I will say that yes, it's a favorable decision. So we can be happy, a decision on right shares. It's pertaining to section 2, 56 subsection 2, 7C. We all are aware, friends, that with effect from 1/10/2009, where an individual or an HUF receives any property without consideration or for an inadequate consideration, the same difference which would amount to be treated as an income as per provisions of section 56 72C. And property here means shares, along with other things, it also means shares and securities, etc., etc. It's friendly, friends, it's nothing but a provision which has been brought out for anti-abuse of law. It's a measure to curb that. SSC, here the facts are, SSC as a karta was holding 15,000 shares in a private limited company, which was, by way of percentage, it was 4.98% of the share capital. SSC was offered 3,13,000 something additional shares at face value of rupees 100 each on a proportionate basis. He subscribed for 1,94,000 shares, and those were allotted on 28th of January 2010. Other shareholders were also offered on same basis and were allotted the shares. Shares including which was not subscribed by the SSC were also allotted on the proportionate basis. The book value as on 31st March 2009, that is the preceding previous year, balance sheet date, as per rule 11U and 11UA was 1538. So the assessing officer book value 1538 minus the 100 rupees, that is the face value, the difference of 1438 was treated as an income under section 56(2), and the matter went to the tribunal. The matter went to the CIT appeal. The CIT appeal also accepted that this is a correct addition. Now the matter went to the tribunal. The issue before the tribunal was whether this provision of 56(2) would be applicable to the right shares. Why, yes or no, the arguments were. First of all, what is the purpose of this section? The provision is to check the bogus capital building. Secondly, right shares are ordinarily, in practice if you see, right shares are ordinarily issued at a discount. If were to be, they were to be issued at either market value or at the value or the book value, then why would one apply for the right shares? So normally it is a practice that the right shares would be issued at a discount. Next argument, it will be if it is to be applied to the right shares, this provision is to be applied to the right shares, it would possibly even apply to the bonus shares as well. Thirdly, the intention is not to cover the right shares, because right in shares becomes shares only after the allotment. It becomes the shares only after the allotment. Till then it is only a right. And here we have seen the word property has been defined as shares and securities. Next, time of taxability. When it is to be taxed? Either in the year when the shares are allotted or in the year when the shares are received. Because if you read the section 56(2), it says when the amount is received, inadequate consideration would apply the year in which it is received. So when is it is to be applied in such type of cases? Now, the reasoning is given by the tribunal. The language of provision is very clear. It is unambiguous. It has given exception in the section. It has also given an exception for the transactions, like transaction between relatives, if it is received on inheritance, if it is on occasion of marriage, etc., etc. It has even covered the transactions which would occur on account of reconstruction of the business, maybe by merger, amalgamation, demerger, etc. Therefore, there is no use going into the intention of the legislature. Secondly, Bonus shares is nothing but capitalization of shares. Example, it is given by way of an example that if an exchange of 100 rupee note is to be done in two parts, it will be 500 rupees note each, that is two, or if it is to be done in 10 parts, it will be 100 rupees into 10 notes. So it is nothing but an proportionate allotment or proportionate distribution of the same capital. Ultimately, the capital remains the same. Therefore, for bonus shares, this provision per se would not apply. To the extent that the value of, it is said, quoted, quote, to the extent the value of property in the additional shares is derived from that of the existing shareholding on the basis of which the same are allotted, no additional property can be said to have been received by the shareholder. Thereafter, friends, we read certain other observations of the court, of the tribunal, which are in para 4.3. As long as, therefore, there is no disproportionate allotment, that is for the right shares, I am saying. As long as there is no disproportionate allotment, that is, shares are allotted pro rata to the shareholders based on their existing holdings, there is no scope for any property being received by them on the said allotment of shares. There being only an apportionment of the value of existing holding over a larger number of shares, there is accordingly no question of section 56(2)(7c), though per se applicable to the transactions, that is of in this genre, getting attracted in such a case. So it is clearly saying that otherwise the right shares, issue of right shares, this provision is applicable only because of it is allotted on the, it is the offer was made on the proportionate basis. This provision is not applicable. The higher than proportionate or a non-uniform allotment, though would and on the same premise attract the rigor of the provisions. This is only understandable in as much as the same would only be to the extent of the disproportionate allotment, and further by suitably factoring the then how the working is given. They have gone ahead and given the working also, how it is to be taxed. Now, in the present case, no addition is justified. That is coming out very clearly on page number 12, that no addition is justified under section 56 in this case, because the SSE was offered in the same proportion and he had accepted in the lower proportion. Lower, the allotment was made to him in the lower proportion because he had accepted, or the offer made was not fully accepted. So qua the others, there was a disproportionate. Now what happens to those cases? I have my own doubt whether they can be reopened also. Those SSCs can be reopened after reading this judgment. Now writing shares, the issue that was raised, that writing shares is not covered in shares and securities. It has been argued that it is simply saying it is covered. The argument is without any basis. On the contrary, the issue should have been that in which, on what date it should be taxable, whether it should be taxable on the date when the shares are issued, or whether it should be taxable on the date when share certificates are received. To that it says that if shares are allotted, here the question was the issue and the receipt both were in the same year, that is the reason why the issue was not there before the tribunal. However, our enthusiastic member did not stop there. He wanted to cover the entirety, and he has proceeded and given his findings on the things were not before the court. It says that shares vest in the name of the shareholder on allotment, only what stands received by the shareholder is the document evidencing its title thereto. So applying this, I think once the shares are allotted, whether you receive the certificate in year, the year after that previous year is not important, the date of allotment becomes important for the chargeability. So friends, I think as far as this judgment goes, though it is in favor of the SSC as far as the proportionate allotment is done. Otherwise, this judgment would go against the SSC for all other reasons that has been spelled out in this judgment. Now, rapidly covering another judgment on penalty 271E. Here, friends, the repayment of the loan were made by journal entry as well as by the cash transactions. As far as the cash transaction, there was no issue. I think the High Court has also held that yes, it is covered and the penalty is leviable under section 271 capital E. As far as the transactions by way of journal entry is concerned, that is the issue we would like to discuss over here. The argument was that the transaction is a genuine transaction. The transaction was between the promoters, that is the directors, and the company. And it's a genuine transaction that has been reflected in the accounts of the directors also. There was no dispute as far as the genuinity and the bona fide of the transaction was covered. There the High Court said that yes, the transaction is genuine and bona fide, and the covering Bombay High Court decision in the case of Trump International and Rajasthan High Court as well as the Punjab High Court, following all the three decisions, it had that the journal entry transactions will not be covered under section 271 capital E. Now friends, if we refer to the Bombay High Court judgment which has been referred in this judgment, Bombay High Court in the case of Trump International, I think many of us would be aware that this Trump International is the Ketan Parekh's company which was involved in security scam, etc., etc. Not to get carried away and be prejudiced on that. As far as this Trump International goes, let me read the relevant and the important observations of the court. In the case of Trump International, it has very clearly mentioned that the argument advanced by the counsel for the SSC that the bona fide transaction of repayment of loan or deposit by way of adjustment to book entries carried out in the ordinary course of business would not come within the mischief of section 269T cannot be accepted, because the section does not make any distinction between the bona fide and non-bona fide transactions and requires that the entities specified thereon not to make repayment of any loan deposit together with the interest in any otherwise than by an account pay check. So the Bombay High Court in the Trump International very clearly says that the provisions would be applicable in case of journal entries also. However, in the present case where the loan deposit has been repaid by debiting the account through journal entries, it must be held that the SSC has contravened the provisions of section 269T of the Act, but applying 271 capital E, in the present case, the cost shown by the SSC for repayment of loan otherwise than by an account pay check was on account of the fact that the SSC was liable to receive amount towards the sale price of the shares sold by the SSC to the person from whom loan or deposit was received by the SSC. Therefore, one side he had to receive the amount on account of the sales and the other side there was a loan. So the journal entry, the two-way transaction was avoided, applying the earlier decision of Supreme Court in the case of J.P. Boda. They had relied that and say the two-way transactions should be avoided or can be avoided, and he was prevented by sufficient cause under section 273 capital E, and that was the reason why this appeal was allowed by the Bombay High Court. These facts have not been brought down in the case that we have discussed, in the case of ASNEW Burials Private Limited. They simply said that it's a bona fide transaction, and if I understand, and a reconciliation of both these decisions of the Bombay Tribal High Courts are to be done, in that case, it's a worry that still today, for all our journal entry transactions, this provisions will be applied. I appreciate that, yes, earlier we had decisions wherein the other courts have held that no, the transactions of journal entry should not apply. I am little bit unable to reconcile that if for this, if a journal entry because of debit and credit is held to be a reasonable cause, then in most of the cases there would be a debit and credit. That is the reason why these journal entries are passed. Otherwise, why the journal entries should have been passed? There should not have been any question. Here in the case of Asnew Burials Private Limited, the journal entry was passed because of certain expenses which were pertaining to the directors. They were appearing in the books of the company. So those were debited to the loan accounts of the directors. So that was a journal entry. So in any case, either because of the expenses or because of the recovery, those journal entries are passed. The only distinguishing factor could be if I had to receive from company A and I had to pay by way of loan to company B. In that case, if I am passing an entry, all the companies, all the three concerns are passing an entry by way of a journal entry. In that case, this would not be treated or covered by the Bombay High Court decision of Trump International, and the provisions of 269T would be hit. So this is one precaution that I would just want to. You mean to say it's not a, it's no loan or deposit?
Correct. But they say loan or deposit of money. That in the case, and I don't think that
first
decision of the Bombay High Court
considered as a decision. I appreciate. I personally feel that yes, reconsideration of the Trump International is required. So that's the reason I said that we should not get carried away, whether it was Ketan Parekh's company or whichever company.
Yeah, but
so bona fide, so that's what I understand. So bona fide transaction and not by the Bombay Tribunal or Bombay High Court very clearly says that is not an issue at all. Whether it's a bona fide, we understand it's a bona fide transaction. But where does the section distinguish? But we have a jurisdictional high court, so that's the precaution I just wanted to bring to your notice. Otherwise I'm with you. The next judgment, I would first rapidly take the last one, then if at all, okay, the 14th judgment is a small judgment which talks about the capital expenditure or the revenue expenditure. Here, friends, the payment was made for lease rent by the SSC. The transfer of that assignment deed of the lease was absolute, that is all rights, title and interest was derived and which was absolute transferred in favor of the SSC. The period was of the lease was for 10 years, though it is saying 20 years, but the period, if I calculate date wise, it takes 10 years. Being the 10 years, and it was further that it can be extendable for another 80 years. So it was treated that it is nothing but the lease in perpetuity. Since it was held the lease in perpetuity, it was held to be a capital expenditure, and the expenditure debited was not allowed as a revenue expenditure. Perpetuity. Land. MIDC. Proportion, yes, in the proportion also the number of years it does not allow. So that's why the problem would be that if at all it does not allow, see, I hear the purpose is it's like a tenancy, that if you are making a lump sum payment, like for our Institute of Chartered Accountants case itself, the issue was whether the provisions of 194I would apply for the land which was acquired for a longer lease period. There they said no, the lump sum payment is basically made for the purpose that they want to acquire the land. The intention is to acquire the land and not the lease of the land.
Right to use. Right to use the land. Instead of
no,
the
right, no. To acquire. Right to use it. It was to acquire the land. Because here also it says that all other rights in the assignment deed were allowed to the title, the transfer rights and were allowed, so it was held to be a capital expenditure. So I would not have understand that how do we, otherwise I understand the land cannot be depreciated. So just as a precaution, I wanted to bring it to your notice. Coming to the last judgment on 234E, friends, this judgment is a writ petition challenging the validity of 234E, which has been filed in Rajasthan High Court, and the court has directed that notice should be issued to the Union Government and to the CBDT why the petition should not be accepted. There is no conclusion to this. Still, we have another two state High Courts, Kerala High Court and as well as the Karnataka High Court, which has also accepted this petition for 234E and state that the recovery cannot be made, the provisions cannot be made applicable till the outcome of this decision. The issue I wanted to bring here is that in Bombay, I understand that when we are receiving the notices of 234E, either this are to be paid by the SSC or they can be disputed in appeal. There is no provision as far as the appeal section 246(1) goes. So the question is whether still it is an appealable order, and I would say that in the under the residuary clause of 246(1)(a), this can be taken saying that I dispute the tax determined. This may be held as a tax that is determined, and the appeal should be filed wherever the amount involved is little substantial. So when these decisions come, there would be all the possibility that because there are now three courts, if further any other courts are there, the Supreme Court may ultimately say that not let us hear different courts, and the Supreme Court may consolidate like how it did for ATSSC, etc. And or it may say that one particular High Court should be taking up this matter, and then, and if at all it comes in favorable, to keep the case live, it is advisable that one should prefer an appeal petition. With these words, friends, I know I have extended a little bit of the time, and I again take an opportunity to thank the chamber for giving me an opportunity and to learn the topics and the case laws that we have discussed today. Thank you, friends.
Thank you, Mahendra bhai. Friends, you will agree with me. The Mahendra bhai has taken us to the very minute analysis of the various decision and on the very covering the very important topics of a practical importance. I thank Mahendra bhai for sparing his valuable time. Friends, I will just again the commitment show the chamber. Mahendra is another example. Whenever I call him for the meetings, either maybe for the study circle or study group, he rather says what date you want to conduct. Rather, he doesn't look at his diary, but he adjusts his timing according to the timing of the other meetings. I thank again from the on behalf of the members of the chamber. I am very thankful for such an approach to the chamber's activity. I request Dinesh bhai to offer a formal vote of thanks for the Mahendra bhai and Mandar.
Before offering vote of thanks, members are requested to renew the membership fee or study group also. Now vote of thanks. I propose hearty vote of thanks to CA Mahendra bhai Sanghvi for leading discussion on recent judgment on the direct taxes with his vast knowledge and experience, which will benefit lot of us. He has masterly analysis the various case law in spite of his busy schedule. He has given his valuable time. Thank you very much, sir. Hearty word of thanks to Mandar Vaidya, advocate, explaining the principle of interpretation of law. His talk will be very helpful to us. Thank you very much. Thank you.